So this lecture will be a brief intermission from philosophy of language entirely. I mean, as you'll see, it is relevant to philosophy of language, as it's relevant to many areas of philosophy, all areas of philosophy. But it is not itself a work of philosophy of language. However, the sixth and final lecture will then draw upon this stuff and do some work in philosophy of language. So we'll all turn back into philosophy of language in the end. Okay, so I'm going to start with the numbers of women in philosophy for the countries that I know best. So in the US, women are just 17% of full-time employed philosophers. The UK, it's 24%, which sounds like a terrible figure unless you've just heard the US one first, in which case it sounds pretty good. But what's striking about both of these figures is that these are the kind of numbers we see in engineering, maths, physics, computer science. These are not the kinds of numbers we see in arts subjects. There hasn't been that much attention devoted to this until recently, and the attention devoted to it has been pretty much exclusively within philosophy. There's been lots of attention from governments devoted to trying to do something about the numbers in science and technology and engineering, because those are considered important for national economies, and strangely, philosophy isn't. So it hasn't had the same attention devoted to it, but the figures are, you know, just as compelling and strange, and perhaps even more so because philosophy is found in the arts and humanities, which is thought of as having much better gender parity. In fact, numbers are equal, and in some subjects, there are more women than men. The pattern of what happens in these countries, and I am saying these countries because I'm aware that things may be quite different here. I was hearing suggestions last night that in Estonia the numbers may be much closer to parity, which is really interesting and makes me want to study it. But in the US, women and men enroll in introductory philosophy classes in roughly equal numbers. They spend in the US a couple years trying to figure out what subject they want to major in. When it comes time to make that decision, it drops down to about 30% female. And then it drops again as you progress through to MA and PhD and a job in the profession. In the UK, it looks initially like something's very, very different because we have roughly equal numbers of male and female philosophy majors. But in fact, this is a product of the way the system works. So in the UK, you enter into a particular department, you're accepted to that department, and it's very, very hard to shift out of it. You spend almost all your time doing classes in that department through your undergraduate degree. So we get students coming in at 50-50. It's hard to get out. At the first chance that you can get out, that is an MA level, it drops down to about 30%. So in both the US and the UK, you actually see what amounts to the same pattern, which is women and men are equally interested in checking out philosophy before they get to university, but something happens during that time, I think, because at the first chance to get out, women leave. I should say I'm focusing on statistics for women in philosophy, largely because we don't have good statistics for groups other than gender. So we have this is all we have on race in philosophy. In the U.S., blacks are 1.32% of graduate students or academic staff. So it's an extremely low number. I don't think we need figures to realize that philosophy is extremely white. I think we can probably all realize this just by looking around us at philosophy conferences, which isn't to say we shouldn't get the figures. I think we absolutely should. But I think we can acknowledge there's a problem without the figures. So there are lots of explanations for this. I'm only going to be talking about a couple of them here. Lots of explanations have been offered. Right now, I'm going to tell you a bit about the ones I'm not going to be discussing beyond this slide. So an ever popular one for any differences between men and women is that actually men and women are innately, unchangeably different psychologically. We need to accept that men are from Mars and women are from Venus, and stop trying to fight nature. I've given a slightly caricatured version. It could be that there are some innate, unchangeable differences between men and women. The best evidence we have to date suggests that if there are some, they are very, very small, and they're not going to explain the large differences that we see in the world. So for people who want to find out more about that, I'd suggest books by Cordelia Fine and Rebecca Jordan Young. Cordelia Fine is an especially nice read for philosophers. She is Kit Fine's daughter. And she writes like she spent a lifetime talking to philosophers. So it's just a wonderfully engaging and good read. She does a really nice job showing the problems of the data that people think support this. Could it be that men and women have different intuitions about standard philosophical thought experiments? This is an explanation that was briefly extremely exciting to people. It was put forward by Wesley Buckwalter and Stephen Stitch. They presented data which seemed to show that women and men have different intuitions about the sort of classic thought experiments that people use to introduce the subject. Their hypothesis was that what happens is that women have intuitions that are different from the ones that are considered right in the literature. You know, when people say, obviously, you know, Ted doesn't know that. and that women finding themselves in these classes with intuitions that go against what's being said to be obviously true will feel like they're not getting it, and they're not comfortable in philosophy, they're not quite sure what's going on, and they'll leave. And Buckwalter and Stitch saw this not as a flaw of women, but as a flaw of the method of thought experiments and intuition mongering. And they were using it as part of an argument that we shouldn't be doing philosophy this way. And this sounded really intriguing. Then Louise Anthony came along, and she looked through the data in more detail, and it turned out that the women and men, there are about 10, there, I think there are 10 experiments that Buckwalter and Stitch looked at, and in 5 of them, women did have the deviant intuitions, and in 5 of them, women had the standard intuitions. So having different intuitions, even if women and men are having different ones, it's not going to explain women's departure in the way that Buckwalter and Stitch thought it would, because men were equally likely to have the deviant intuitions. Could it be that it is difficult to combine work with childcare and women do more of the child rearing? Obviously, these things are true. Women do, in fact, in our cultures, do more of the child rearing, and it is difficult to combine work with childcare. But that's not going to explain why philosophy has such low numbers of women compared to other subjects. It's not that women in philosophy have lots and lots of babies and women in history don't. Right? So that's not going to do it. Could it be conscious, good old-fashioned sexism, people who will openly assert that women are less intelligent than men and less good at philosophy than men? Yes, to some extent. That still exists. I know philosophers who openly assert things like that, some of whom are extremely prominent. But they are actually quite rare. So I like to think that's actually not so widespread, that this is not the world we're living in anymore. I mean, it's going to be happening some places with some people, and it's going to have really terrible effects. But this is not going to explain the extent of the phenomenon that we see. Could it be sexual harassment? There's been a lot of attention to sexual harassment in recent years. I've been quite involved with that attention, and I have a whole other hour-long paper I could give on that topic. I think sexual harassment is a problem, a major problem for women in philosophy, and it does drive women out of the field. We do not have comparative data on levels of sexual harassment in philosophy versus other fields. We never will. You can't get good data on sexual harassment. It is generally underreported. When it is reported, there are usually confidentiality agreements put in place. We're not going to get good data on that. We know it's a problem. We're not going to know exactly what causal role it plays. We're not going to be able to compare it with other subjects. I'm going to put it aside now, but if people want to ask me about that in questions, I can talk about it. So I think there are very good reasons to believe that there are certain largely unconscious psychological phenomena that are playing a role in bringing about and sustaining the underrepresentation of women in philosophy, and also the underrepresentation of other and overlapping groups. Now, I thought I'd just make a little digression to tell you some facts about my department. I will say I absolutely adore my department, and always have. That's why I've been there 20 years. It's my first job. I stayed. However, I was hired in 1995. In 1999, we hired another woman to a permanent academic post. That brought the total number of women in the department to 2. From 1999 to 2012, we filled 10 new permanent academic posts. We hired 0 new permanent women. During that time, I was on almost every hiring committee, everyone but one, when I was on research leave. I have always been very feminist. And my colleagues are, as I said, lovely people. The 3 men on the committee with me were always very feminist. We always very much wanted to hire a woman. The one time it wasn't me on the committee, it was Rosanna Keefe, and she's just as feminist as I am. All of our intentions were, we had the best of intentions. We just kept hiring men. And my partner, after about maybe even the 3rd time, kept saying, "Jenny, you keep hiring men." There's a pattern here. And he got increasingly vociferous about this as the years went on. So, you know, I'd say, "But this really was just the best candidate. I mean, we're all very feminist. We really wanted to hire a woman, but it just worked out this way." And he'd say, "Yes, that's what you said the other 9 times. And it's happened again. You've got to look at this pattern." So one of the, and I think he was onto something. And here I want to pause to say, this shows how difficult it is to understand these things while you're in the middle of it, while you're doing it yourself. Like I said, I am very explicitly committed feminist woman, and I was not seeing it. It also shows, people sometimes think that men don't have a role to play in this, that men should kind of keep their mouths shut because they might screw up, and they should let the women take these issues forward. Well, in this case, the woman was screwing up, and the man had some really good things to say. Right? So I think it's really important to remember that. So how could it be? How could there be an explanation for that pattern other than chance? Well, lots of ways. I'm going to talk about 2 things that I think do play a role in producing patterns like that when you've got people of perfectly good will who really are trying to do the right thing, and it keeps turning out that way. So these are rough characterizations. So one thing is implicit biases. The ones that I'm going to be talking about here are largely unconscious biases or associations that affect the way that we perceive, evaluate, and interact with members of social groups, both the groups that are stigmatized in our cultures and the groups that are elevated and thought of as wonderful in our cultures. Which groups those are will vary by culture, of course, and what the stereotypes are will vary by culture. And the second thing I'll talk about is stereotype threat. And this is often run together with implicit bias, but it is quite a different phenomenon. And both these are related to stereotypes of groups, but they work differently. A stereotype threat is a phenomenon in which people's awareness of their own group membership can impair their performance under certain circumstances. So the actual performance declines. It can also make them very uncomfortable and make them want to leave certain environments. So we'll start with implicit bias. Okay. So, well-known fact, everybody accepts that human beings form and act quickly on associations, unconsciously, automatically, very fast. It's a useful survival skill. It's good that, you know, if I see a fire in front of me, I don't look at it and think, that's a kind of nice color. It's orange. I wonder what it feels like. You know, it's good that we just, you know, run without thinking about it. It's useful. But it's not so useful when it comes to our associations with social groups. Psychologists have, over the last few decades, been starting to understand the effects that these fast associations have on our dealings with members of social groups and our social categorizations. And the effects are quite disturbing. So I'm going to be talking about how these associations can work to the detriment of people who are in stigmatized groups. And we've never done all these lectures in a series together. Here I am talking about Jesse Jackson again. I have a picture of Jesse Jackson here to illustrate two things. He tells a story that I think shows some very important things about implicit bias. So Jackson has devoted his entire life to campaigning for civil rights in America, to trying to improve the position of black people in America. And he says that one of the most disturbing experiences he's ever had is finding that if he's walking alone late at night in an unfamiliar city, and he hears footsteps behind him, he turns around and he's relieved if he sees that it's a white man. And what this is a case in which Jackson's implicit biases are rising up to the surface, and he's becoming conscious of them and realizing that he implicitly has a fear of black men. Even though he is himself a black man, even though he has devoted his entire life to campaigning against negative stereotypes of black people. So nobody's immune to these implicit biases. You can have them even if you are a member of the group that they're about, even if you are explicitly, genuinely devoted to fighting for egalitarianism. If you want to find out about your implicit biases, you can do this. You can have a very disturbing afternoon. How many people have taken the implicit association test? A few people. You go to Project Implicit online at Harvard, and you can take implicit association tests on lots and lots and lots of different categories and get some sense of what your implicit biases are. If you do this, you must be absolutely sure to select the right country for you, whatever the right country is. It will default to American, and then you'll get like names of American celebrities and things. So you know, categories like African American that don't make sense if you're not in America. So be sure to select the right country. And you'll also be adding to their data sets, which is good for science. So how does this affect academia? Okay, well, it's been shown that anonymous marking at university level leads to higher marks for women. I don't know, do you have anonymous marking here? No? Okay, it's extremely widespread. It's the norm in the UK. It's completely unheard of in the US, where I come from. But it seems to have good effects. It doesn't, the effects, I think, are not so strong if it's handwritten exams. It's perhaps worth noting, because people are actually very good at guessing gender from handwriting. But with typewritten things, it makes a difference. And there's been a recent study on the marking of elementary school math exams and math lessons, and it shows that girls at elementary school level wind up with higher marks if the math exams are marked anonymously, and the ones that are marked anonymously also have a higher level of interest in math, which may be because they're getting more positive feedback. Because being marked anonymously, they're getting the better marks and they're being told they're good at math. There have been lots of studies of the effects of implicit bias on hiring. And these studies take a really nice form. The classic study is you take one of the same, so you take a single CV and you slap different names at the top of it. So it's exactly the same qualifications, just a different name, and you see how that CV is received. And it turns out that with a male name at the top of it, it's considered a much better CV than with a female name. With a typically white name, it's a much better CV than with a typically Arab or black name. All of the things that you'd predict occur there. You can do sort of tweaks to the study to test for effects of sexual orientation, and it turns out that straight people's CVs look best. You can tweak the study so that you're testing for the effects of parenthood. It turns out that parenthood makes a man's CV look better, and it makes a woman's CV look worse. So lots of interesting things you can find out with these CV studies. Quite disturbing. People like to think this is something that's going to be dying out, but the most recent study showing this effect was 2012, which isn't very long ago. And the most interesting thing about that study, I think, was that the effect, the preference for men's CVs over women's, was equally strong for all age groups. So the younger men and women in the study were just as likely to show the biases as the older ones. So it's not something where people can say, oh, but the people who have those biases will be retiring soon. So it's something we should take action against. It's perhaps worth noting this effect is one that occurs with CVs of sort of ordinary, difficult to rank kind of category. If you have absolute superstar, this person is setting the world on fire, has already published 10 things in mind, this isn't going to show up. There have been studies of abstract review that, again, they show the very same abstract gets a higher rating with a male name than a female name. The effect is especially strong with topics that are thought of as male. And women are considered most appealing if they're doing female topics. We get effects of this in teaching. Both men and women are more likely, in fact, all of these effects are both men and women who are affected by it. Both men and women are more likely to call on male students, which is very easy to correct for once you become aware of it. When a student makes one of those inchoate contributions where you can't tell if they're fumbling after something interesting or just saying stuff, people are more likely to charitably interpret the men than the women. A thing that's been shown over and over that people talk a lot about in the business world as well is that if a woman raises a point, it will often be ignored until it's restated by a man, at which point it will be taken up and attributed to the man. There's a study that I think came out last summer of prospective PhD students sending emails to possible supervisors. Again, they did it with exactly the same email and varied the name at the top of it. And it turns out they're looking at race and gender. And the supervisors were most likely to respond to the emails by white men. Again, just exactly the same email, they're only varying the name. There's some very nice studies of letters of reference. So the sorts of things that men get in their letters of reference are adjectives like brilliant, outstanding, and original, which are just what we want to see in a letter of reference. And they're things that sort of fit with male stereotypes better. Men tend to be stereotyped as agentic and excelling and doing things. Women are nice and helpful and kind. So women get described as working hard, which is a good thing. It's a genuine virtue, right? You want to hire someone who works hard, but if you have a choice between the CV that says works hard and the CV that says brilliant, friendly. Again, it's a real virtue, right? I want to work with people who are friendly. Surprise. I don't know, with your national slogan, Yeah, that's unfortunate, that one. It gets worse. Very attractive. And the utterly irrelevant, friends with my wife. Okay, so women are more likely to have things that are called grindstone adjectives, sort of communal adjectives, delt raisers, like surprisingly successful, and what gets categorized as irrelevant comments. And I have to say that after reading about this, I went back and I looked at my letters of reference, and I'm pleased to say that I didn't describe any students as attractive or friends with my wife, or even surprisingly successful. But I noticed that I was more likely to say that my women students were friendly and hardworking than that my men students were, even though my men students were equally friendly and hardworking. Now, I happen to think these are genuine virtues, so what I did was I started putting them into my letters of reference for the men as well, if they were true. But I also made sure that I described the women as brilliant and outstanding. If it was true, that is. Okay. So there have been lots of studies done showing in various different ways that people have trouble coping with and understanding and viewing women as leaders. We talked about this at dinner a couple nights ago, I think. This is just one of the studies. So what you do in this study is you show people an image roughly like this, and you ask them, who is the leader in this meeting? 100% of people, okay, the white guy at the head of the table. He's at the head of the table. Everyone's looking to him. He's clearly the leader. If you show people a picture like this, only 50% of people will take the woman at the head of the table. What this shows is that even being literally recognized as a leader is twice as hard for women. Right, so just getting over that barrier, it's going to be twice as difficult for women. And this study has been repeated over and over with the same results. And that affects things, obviously it's going to affect things like, you know, running a department or something. It also affects teaching, because teaching is an authority position. And your students need to look to you as an authority figure. And they need to respect you as an authority figure. And that turns out to be more difficult for women. So I have an anecdote here from Louise Anthony. And Louise Anthony, if you've ever met her, she's one of the most authoritative people I've ever met. She's not shy, she is not quiet, she is not, you know, soft-voiced and feminine. She is, you know, shows all the assertive traits that you expect a leader to show. But here's what she said happened to her. If students or conference participants challenge women more than they do men, women have to face choices that men do not, and these choices are likely to be double binds. So, for example, when I taught a course to engineers that was usually taught by a male colleague, he advised me to brook absolutely no excuses for late papers and to announce, as he always did, that students would simply be docked 5 points for every day late. When I found that I had over 40 late papers and that many of them were so late they would have a failing grade before I even read them, I asked him what he did. Did he disregard the announced policy, or did he let the chips fall where they may, leading to failing grades for quite a few students? His answer, that's never happened to me. Thus, he never had to face the dilemma of either undermining his own authority by not following his announced policy, or evoking the ire of 40 students in a class that didn't like you to begin with. So it's going to make it much more difficult for women to be treated seriously as an authority. So, I've given you a few examples of the kinds of effects implicit bias have in academia. I think this results in injustices. There are people not receiving the marks that they should if work isn't being anonymously marked. Hiring isn't being based on merit, but it's being based partly on the name at the top of the CV. Women's career progress is being impeded in various ways. So now we'll talk about stereotype threat. So this is, it's usually talked about as an underperformance effect, but it's not just that. It's underperformance at particular tasks but members of groups that are thought of as not very good at those tasks. But only under certain circumstances. When they really care about doing well, the stakes are high, and crucially, something happens to remind them of their group membership. In addition, underperformance, this can also lead to avoidance, to just the sense that I don't want to be here doing this, I'm going to drop out of this degree program, or drop this class. It's worth noting that stereotype, another way that stereotype threat differs from implicit bias, is that stereotype threat is based on explicit conscious knowledge of the stereotypes that are widely held in your culture. You don't necessarily endorse them, but you're aware that those stereotypes are there. So some people understand it as a sort of unconscious fear of confirming those stereotypes, but it's a concern with the fact that those stereotypes are in the air, the researchers like to say. So a classic example of this has been studied a lot is women taking math tests. Women who are reminded of their gender when they're taking a math test do less well. The way of doing this can be very simple. It can be being the only woman or one of just a couple women in an overwhelmingly male room leads to lower test results than if there are higher numbers of women in the room. Or, a nice way of testing for this is you have the woman take a math test and you have two versions of it. In one version, there's a question at the start, about demographic data. You take a box indicating your gender, and the other version, the box indicating your gender is at the end of the test. The women who tick that box at the end of the test do substantially better than the women who tick the box at the beginning of the test, because ticking that box reminds them of their gender. There have been a lot of studies of black men at universities in the US. If they're taking tests that are presented as tests of academic ability, they will underperform. If you give them the very same test and tell them that it is a test of human reasoning processes, their performance goes way up. Now, I phrase this all very carefully. I've been talking about groups that are stigmatized at particular tasks rather than stigmatized groups. And the reason is that that's what it is for stereotype threat. This isn't just about groups that are generally stigmatized or underprivileged in some way. So I think we can all agree that white men at Ivy League universities like Harvard and Yale in the United States are not an underprivileged group. But if you have them do a test of their athletic ability and you do something to remind them how white they are, they will underperform. If you tell them that you're just studying human physiology, their performance goes way up. And so anyone can suffer from stereotype threat in the right circumstances. And it can happen very young. They've found stereotype threat in 5 to 7 year old girls doing math tests. If you have them color in a picture of a sunset before taking a math test, sunset is gender neutral, they'll do much better than if you have them color in a picture of a girl holding a baby doll. Because a girl holding a baby doll is stereotypically female, and that leads to a decline in their performance, because it reminds them that they're girls. Okay. So you put these together and you get an unhappy picture. So people who are members of stigmatized groups will have a harder time getting proper credit for what they do because of implicit bias, and they'll have a harder time doing as well as they could. And a lot of this will be occurring without anyone consciously, intentionally doing anything wrong. It's all people of goodwill. You can still have this happen. Now, I haven't said much about philosophy yet, so I'm going to turn to that a little bit now. As I said, philosophy hasn't been much studied. I'm actually trying to rectify that. I've got some studies going on now that I can talk about a bit in questions. I'm also hoping to get a lot of money and do more. So philosophy is overwhelmingly male. The lecturers are overwhelmingly male. The syllabi, the reading lists are overwhelmingly male. The speakers at conferences are overwhelmingly male. The papers you get in introductory anthologies. So you would expect that to lead to a lot of these phenomena occurring. It also contains a lot of what Helen Beattie described as stereotypically male aggressive behavior. And here I want to be very clear about what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the method of argument and counterexample as aggression. That is an adversarial method, but it needn't be done aggressively. You can be really nice and friendly and talk about and present arguments and counterexamples. What Beebe's talking about and what I would be talking about is the kind of seminar behavior in which the goal is to destroy the speaker. The goal is to win. So she describes a department she was once in where the department kept in its lounge a scoreboard for the department seminar, so home team wins and away team wins. Right. And this is not about doing philosophy anymore, if that's what you're doing, right? This is about winning. And that's something that's stereotypically male. And if you're, you know, trying to destroy the speaker every time, rip them apart, see if you can reduce them to tears, that shows you're not actually focused on the philosophy. You're focused on something else, some sort of display of your own power, rather than on actually getting to the truth. And that is something that is stereotyped as male in our culture, and this can have a couple of different effects. So Beebe points out that that can trigger stereotype threat in women because this is stereotypically male behavior. Louise Anthony points out that puts women in a double bind. If that's what it is to be a good philosopher, then women face a choice. That's a difficult one, because if you do that, you're being a good philosopher, but a really terrible woman. Right, because that's not how women are supposed to behave, and you will be described in very nasty terms. If you don't do that, then you'll be, you know, friendly and helpful and hardworking, but you won't be a brilliant philosopher because that's what a brilliant philosopher does. I also think it's very likely that the stereotypes that are associated with math will carry over to logic, and logic is often treated as foundational in philosophy, so that's very likely to have the effect of driving women out of philosophy. So now I'll talk about what one can do about this. I'm going to start with what one shouldn't do. Okay. So one thing that I think people like to do is say, okay, this is all really bad, so I'm not going to be biased. Don't be biased, don't be biased. Okay. Don't do that. It's going to backfire and make it worse. It might work for a little while. There are studies that show it working for a brief while, but then people become more biased afterwards. Absolutely don't tell yourself to be objective. And this is an interesting one, because I think philosophers are very into their own objectivity, mostly. It turns out that priming people with objectivity increases their levels of implicit bias, increases the manifestation of implicit bias. And especially if you think approvingly about how objective you are, you're especially likely to display bias in your subsequent behavior. So don't do those things. Well, putting women on hiring committees has been a popular remedy for a long time. That's why I was on all those hiring committees. It doesn't always work, obviously. It can help a bit, but women are just as likely to have the negative implicit biases about women as men are. There's absolutely no difference between women and men on those levels. And of course, if you just put one woman on your hiring committee, even if she is saying the right things, we know from other data that women have trouble getting their contributions taken seriously. So it's not terribly likely she'll be able to sway the committee. But it's also not terribly likely that she'll be the one with the insights. But putting a woman on a hiring committee can help in other ways. Having an all-male room and a female job candidate will lead to stereotype threat. Having some women in the room will reduce it. Probably one woman's not going to be enough, though. Another thing that the woman in the room can do, which is useful, is she can be what's called a counter-stereotypical exemplar. A counter-stereotypical exemplar is somebody who's a member of the stigmatized group, of the stereotype group, who doesn't fit the stereotype. And exposure to counter-stereotypical exemplars has been shown to reduce both stereotype threat and implicit bias. You can see this even with implicit association tests. If people spend a few minutes looking at a picture of Martin Luther King before they take the implicit association test about race, they won't show the same levels of race bias. So having a woman in the room can help in that regard. But it's got to be the right woman. So bringing in a woman from human resources or having a woman secretary in the room isn't going to do it, right? It's got to be a respected woman philosopher. So what else can you do? I'm going to give a bunch of different suggestions. Many of these, not all of them, can be motivated quite independently, I think, of concerns about implicit bias and stereotype threat. They're generally good things to do. Okay. So one is to anonymize whatever you can. So I think anonymous marking is a great thing for this reason. I have here a picture of my cousin Gail. My cousin Gail spent a decade back in the 1970s trying to get a job as a French horn player in orchestras in the United States. And she spent a decade unemployed, not able to get any job at all. And then orchestras started, I'm not sure what led them to do this, but a lot of orchestras did at the same time. They started auditioning candidates behind a screen so that all you could do was hear their music. You couldn't see their sex or race or anything else. And that's when she got a job, her first job, with the Chicago Symphony. And she was not alone. There's a huge influx of women into orchestras when they started auditioning behind a screen. Now, obviously, we can't do this in philosophy, right? If we want to have somebody who is going to be a good lecturer, we need to know what they're like at explaining things orally, and it wouldn't be appropriate to test this by having them, you know, speak and give their job talk from behind a screen with a voice distorter. So we can't fully anonymize the process. I mean, maybe if you're just hiring a researcher who's not going to do any teaching, you could, but I'm not even sure about that. However, there may be parts of the process that could be anonymized, and that's something I have a lot to say about. I've done a lot of work on that. I'll talk a little bit more about it later. Getting more counter-stereotypical exemplars around really helps, because as I said, they help to fight implicit bias and stereotype threat. You can get them lots of ways. More students, more lecturers, more researchers. Bring them in as visiting speakers if you don't have enough women in your department. Remember to invite them to speak at conferences. Put women on your reading lists, and then you get more counter-stereotypical exemplars. That reduces the influence of the biases, it fights stereotype threat, and it also sort of helps to change the regularities in the world that these biases feed on. Now, the objection at this point that is standardly raised is that means when you're drawing up your reading list or deciding who to invite for your conference, basing your judgment in part on something other than merit. To which my answer is yes. Our judgments are already based on something other than merit. We know that from the CV studies. You've got exactly the same CV, you change the name at the top of it, and the judgment changes. That's not judgment of merit. So our judgments are already not merit-based. This is a way of improving them. Our judgments are now based on social prejudices. We could do something to improve that. So this is, I realize, the most controversial part of the paper, and I'm now going to move to the least controversial part of the paper, which is, in fact, the thing about implicit bias that I'm most excited about, the discovery that's made me happiest. It turns out that consuming glucose reduces the manifestation of implicit bias. Isn't that a fantastic fact? So every hiring committee should have a platter like this in the center of the table. Human resources department should provide it. Whenever you're marking, be sure you have enough sugar on hand. Whenever you're, you know, whenever you're doing something where your biases might come into play, it's worth noting at this point that implicit biases come into play throughout our lives at unexpected times. I mean, it could affect the way you interact with somebody on the bus, so, you know, just to be sure. Right. So, glucose helps. In more generally, being hungry, tired, and rushed increases the manifestation of implicit bias. Now, being rushed and tired is kind of a fact of life for most academics. You can do something about being hungry, but you can also push on the being rushed. I've been kind of shocked at the processes that are sometimes centrally set up at the university for hiring. We'll have very, very, very tight time scales for, you know, I'll be sent, you know, 30 CVs to read at 6 o'clock at night for a meeting the next day at 10. And that's just a recipe for implicit bias. And, you know, we can push back against that kind of thing. So other things to do if you're hiring. It's very important to agree on the criteria that you're using in advance and on the weighting that you're going to give to those criteria. The reason is that there have been studies showing that if you don't do that, then these things will shift with gender in order to justify your decisions. So if you have a male and a female candidate, the job requires both credentials and experience. One candidate has one candidate has the other. If the male candidate has the credentials, then people will suddenly start thinking credentials are the most important thing. If the female candidate has the credentials, people will think the experience is the most important thing. And they do this without realizing that they're shifting this way. But if you come to a prior agreement on what the criteria are and how you'll weight them, and you make sure you discuss each of those, you can mitigate against that. It's also important not to put too much weight on any one thing, in particular on the thing that might be heavily affected by something like stereotype threat. So at least in the US and UK, it's very common for the job talk to be the most important part of the hiring process. This is an incredibly high stakes event that comes at the end of the process, in which the person presents their paper to a room full of very generally very aggressive, very white male philosophers. So it's going to be an extremely stereotype threat-inducing environment. It's probably not going to be the best performance for anyone, but it's probably going to be especially difficult for those who face stereotype threat. And what's important to remember is that because it's the last thing and it's the most vivid thing, people tend to give it the highest weight. But if you actually are interested in how good someone's work is, you might think that their published papers would be a better guide to that than how they perform in this really weird, artificial, stress-inducing environment. So making sure that adequate weight is given to all the various different elements of the process can make a difference. And along those lines, it's important to get feedback on each element as you go explicitly, rather than overall gestalt feedback of, I just feel like this one's the best. Because those are the judgments that wind up being most biased. If you break it down to specific components and you require people to justify them, it's less biased. Other things that you can do as a teacher, you can, or as a chair, you can try harder to notice when a woman is wanting to speak. If a woman's comment is being ignored or attributed to someone else, anyone in the room can say, hey, isn't that what Betty said? You can do active chairing to prevent just a few people from dominating the discussion. And as I've already talked about, you can focus on doing good philosophy rather than winning or destroying the speaker. It's very much worth re-examining your letters of reference to see if they have that sort of gendered content I pointed to. When that study came out, lots of philosophers I was Facebook friends with were going back and looking at the references and saying, oh my God. I just realized I left off my slide about citation studies. Women are cited much less than men, and there are studies showing this in philosophy as well. Another thing to do is to look at your bibliographies and see if there might be some women you should be citing that you neglected to cite. Again, this is something where people, once they go and do that, look at the bibliographies and think, oh God, yes, of course I should have cited those women. I just didn't think to do it. It's easy to correct. Some other things that work just for stereotype threat. One is called activating an alternative identity. We're all members of multiple different social groups. So, you know, I'm a woman, I'm a white person, I'm British, I'm American, I'm an immigrant, I'm a philosopher. And some of these identities are stigmatized in certain ways and other ones aren't. If you focus on a non-stigmatized identity, it can really help your performance. So this is something you can tell your students to do. That study of the 5 to 7 year old girls, some of them were Asian American. And Asian American girls are stereotyped, or Asian Americans in general, are stereotyped as really good at math. If you had those girls color in a picture of chopsticks before taking their math test, their performance went up. So what you can do is you get your logic, if your logic students are thinking of themselves as women, they might be feeling like they'll do badly. But if you get them to think of themselves as philosophers at the best philosophy department in Estonia, then they're going to be, that's not a group that's stereotyped as bad at logic. So you get them to think about themselves with a group membership that doesn't bear the negative stereotype. Another thing that's been shown to have big effects on stereotype threat is having people a bit older than the group that you're concerned about, who are members of the stereotype group, who have succeeded despite the barriers, come and talk about that. And that's been shown with African-American men in the US to improve their performance at university levels by like a full letter grade. Just having people come and do that a couple times at the beginning of the year. Talking about stereotype threat as a possible source of anxiety has raised women's marks in maths and physics classes by a full letter grade. So has what's called a values affirmation exercise. I don't know how this would play in Estonia. It's an American thing. I don't know how well it would work in the UK. I haven't tried it because it seems very American. I guess the term value affirmation just sounds very American to me. But what it is you get people in the context where they're likely to suffer from stereotype threat, like the physics class or the math class, to spend 15 minutes writing about some value that's important to them. And it turns out doing that increases women's marks by a full letter grade for the rest of the term. It has no effect at all on men's marks, but it increases women's marks. So strange but true. Other thing that I think philosophers need to do anyway is stop talking about being smart. So Eric Schwitzkepel has argued very nicely that judgments of smartness are really judgments of how well people conform to the stereotypes that we have of smartness, which tend to follow facts about social group, like white middle class men with a certain kind of intonation pattern. So they're unlikely to be reliable. They're going to follow patterns of implicit bias. We shouldn't be making them. I think they're also remarkably insensitive to evidence. So you get people saying, he's really smart. He just can't really, get into his papers yet. He just hasn't shown up in his work. Or, she's not that smart. She just works really hard. So they're not sensitive to evidence. We shouldn't respect them. It's also based on what Carol Dweck, psychologist, calls an entity view of intelligence, which is that intelligence is this fixed thing. Each person's got a certain amount of it. It's just sort of fixed for life. And so things are the smart people and the not smart people. And that view of intelligence turns out to make people more prone to implicit bias, more prone to stereotype threat. Also, those who hold that view are less likely to persevere in the face of difficulty when they start having trouble with a difficult intellectual task. Because they'll think, oh, this is indicating I'm not smart. I don't have that as much intelligence as I thought I had. Whereas the people who view intelligence as something that can be developed and cultivated through your activities will think, okay, this is something I need to work on a bit more. So, bad in those ways. There's a very recent fascinating study, another one by Sarah Jane Leslie, colleagues, where she looked at a huge range of fields in academia and the extent to which people in those fields believe that success in their field is due to innate genius you know, having that X factor, that being, you know, that being smart thing. And it turns out to be a really lovely correlation, and the fields where people hold that belief are the ones with the lowest numbers of women and black people. And this is what you'd expect when you have genius stereotypes that are very strongly associated with whiteness and maleness. So, I don't think it's very interesting to sit around having conversations about who's smart. I also think it's, you know, really destructive in all of these ways. But I think we can easily substitute something that's much more philosophically respectable and much less damaging, which is talking about specific virtues of specific papers and specific ideas and specific arguments. And then you're actually doing philosophy. So that's what I think we should be doing instead. So I thought I'd say a little bit about what we did in our efforts to anonymize, because it's actually quite hard to anonymize a job search, so I thought I'd talk a little bit about planning people at this, be more if they want to. So we've done, I think, 3 job searches like this now. I asked for anonymous CVs and cover letters, which we used for shortlisting. So for the shortlisting stage, we had just the CV and writing sample with the number assigned to it. If you want to do this, and your university uses an electronic recruitment system, well, actually, whether it does or not, you need to have an assistant whose job it is to go through these and make sure that they're actually anonymous and assign numbers to them. If you have an electronic recruitment system, it should be easier, but it's in fact harder, because most electronic recruitment systems, even if people give you perfectly anonymous documents, they will put the name of the candidate into the file name automatically. So they're not set up to facilitate this, unfortunately. But you can make this work if you have an assistant to do that. Then, after shortlisting, we got to longlisting stage, which we did based on anonymous writing samples. In one of the searches, after people wrote up comments on the writing samples, they were allowed to get access to the names and look at the references. The committee was divided on whether they wanted to do that or not, so we allowed it this time. In fact, the people who wanted to look at the references, when they had to look at them this late in the process, after already spending a lot of time with the CVs and writing samples, they said the references were just pointless at that point because they'd already thought so much about the candidates and thought they didn't take them seriously. You know, they didn't actually add anything to the picture. I will say also, so this led us in later searches to not bother with references until after we had shortlisted. I think another reason for reducing the role of references is national differences in reference writing. Having been on quite a lot of job searches, I've seen that every American candidate is the greatest student I've ever had. And I know from reading my British colleagues' references as well as the references that come in that if there's a really great British student, they'll be described as maybe having a future in the subject. And I've been hearing about other, I think Europeans in general tend to be more on the British side of the references. So I think that actually having references in at an early stage, certainly using references at the first stage, gives an unfair advantage to Americans. I say this as an American who benefited from this advantage. But that's not the only thing that I did to try to fight implicit bias. So I also made sure that when we were discussing job candidates in the panel, the discussion was tightly structured. People weren't allowed to just give gestalt overall judgments at the start of who they liked. Instead, we had a separate discussion for each candidate of each separate element that we'd agreed we cared about. You know, the written work that they'd sent in advance, the job talk, their teaching ability, the things that they could cover for us. You know, all the things that we wanted to discuss. We talked about each of those separately for each candidate. And then only after doing that did we have any comparative judgments. We also had an endless stream of sugary snacks. And even the people who were somewhat dubious about the process at the start, they actually, you know, they were all willing to give it a try, and they felt that this was the best discussions they'd ever had in hiring. They felt really confident of our choices after having this kind of discussion. So, something that always comes up in discussions of implicit bias is whether we should be blaming ourselves and others for having these. And this is a subject of considerable controversy in the literature. I think that in lots of cases, not in all, implicit biases are both unconscious and blameless. I think if you're completely unaware of your implicit biases or the existence of implicit bias as a phenomenon in the world, and you don't know about the sorts of effects that these will have, you can't be blamed for having those biases. I think even after you become aware of them, if you don't know what to do about them, you might be doing the wrong thing. You might be aware of it, but telling yourself, be objective, be objective, be objective, right? Again, you're doing the wrong thing. You need to learn. So I think in those cases, blame isn't appropriate. But I also think that if people learn about implicit bias, and then they say, oh, that's kind of interesting, whatever, that they do become blameworthy. Because then you're aware of it and you know what to do about it. And I should mention, I always apologize at this point, actually, because you may have entered this room entirely blameless, but now I've told you about implicit bias and what you can do about it, and place new burdens of responsibility on you. And then just as a footnote, since 2012, we've managed to hire 6 new permanent women in the department, so it is possible to change these things. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, I have some type of question, same system.
Thank you. Question and a comment. So I was, first of all, I was wondering about what do you think there's a connection between implicit biases in different fields or topics, right? So, I mean, but if there are implicit biases against women in general, then nonetheless, somehow, philosophy does much worse than, say, in UK, in the States at least, as, say, arts or history and so on. One would think that, oh, maybe it's just a different stereo, right? Just female topics, as you mentioned, by passingly. But then again, someone did recently the survey of the evaluations posted and rated by professors, the American site where students can rate their evaluated professors. And then there were also, like, no matter, it didn't matter what area you were considering, the evaluations, there was always a difference in evaluations and not in favor of women, right? And very, you know, divided along the same lines as you mentioned. The hardworking, friendly, blah blah blah, which was brilliant. So, yes, the man.
Yeah.
But so I wonder what you think about this question,
yeah.
And whether there is one. And then a little comment on the values affirmation. We actually have the SPEED value program, which is run by the Center for Ethics, which is affiliated to the university.
Yeah, I was hearing about that last night. Yeah.
Yeah. So in principle, they should be interested in these value affirmations.
So, okay. It's absolutely true that a lot of these are general problems that women will face and are not specific to philosophy. Now, some things are specific to philosophy. So, for example, if you've got, let me rephrase that. If you've got a room that's overwhelmingly male, it's going to be harder for women, and that's going to happen more in philosophy than it does in French, right? So there are some things that you can look at that way. I also think the aggressive discussion style is something specific to philosophy. I've heard that even lawyers aren't this bad, except those who are also philosophers, who shall remain nameless. But there's also the role of logic in the subject, which is going to carry over all the math stereotypes that we already know exist, and so philosophy is going to get that coming in. But, of course, there's an interesting question of whether there are implicit associations of philosophy as male. Right? And I have actually tried to study this. I've had some very interesting results, which I have not yet published. So it's complicated. I want to do more studies because I'm not entirely sure that I've got the right paradigm for studying it. But I did implicit association tests. And what I found was really strange. So I found that men did indeed implicitly associate philosophy with maleness. I found that women associated philosophy more and more with femaleness as they spent more time in philosophy, which this is the implicit associations, which is kind of puzzling. It could be that those women are seeking out works by women in philosophy and doing, you know, things that will shore up the association between women and philosophy. I mean, women in other fields do sorts of protective things like that, so that's something that I want to study, whether women are doing that. There are a lot of possible explanations for that, but it is puzzling given the demographics of the field. But another thing that I did find was that both women and men who spent more time reading feminist philosophy were more likely to associate philosophy with femaleness. So that would go with the idea that women may be doing that and that that's having an effect, but men are not doing that to the same extent. And so men are tending to associate philosophy with maleness. And of course, reading feminist philosophy would be two things. One is being exposed to feminism, another is that you'd be encountering a lot of women philosophers, so a lot of counter-stereotypical exemplars who are going to be shaking up your stereotypes. I also studied explicit stereotypes. And both men and women strongly, explicitly stereotype philosophy as male. And to equal extents, there's almost no differences between stereotypes of philosophy between men and women. The only difference we found was that men think of philosophy as white to a greater extent than women do. So I don't know what's going on with that. So I should stop and blathering on.
Can I have very short follow-up. So, but what do you mean by saying that the stereotype is male? Is it something like, you know, if you think of a philosopher, it's like Socrates comes to mind, troublemaker, and this is what the philosopher should be, and you know, it's not that you immediately think of a woman, you know, think of a
Is
this something?
Okay, so the way that you test for implicit stereotype, for the implicit associations, is what's with an implicit association test. And when you're doing one of those, what you get is, the most famous implicit association test is the race one, where you have black and white faces and good and bad adjectives, and you're supposed to press a key on the left if it's black or good, press a key on the right if it's white or bad, the thing that pops up at the top of the screen, and then it switches back and forth between how the categories are divided up, and it turns out that people have a very hard time classifying white and bad together, and a very hard time classifying black and good together. And so you do this with philosophy, and it's about classifying woman and philosophy together, or versus man and philosophy together. And so that's how I tested the implicit stereotype, the implicit associations. On the explicit associations, we did that with the standard methodology where you ask people to list off all that you get. You know, I think we had about 40 people who had list off all the traits that they could think of philosophers. And then we got we took like the top 40 of those traits and had a much larger sample rate those traits for typicality. And so then the most typical traits include maleness for both men and women.
Well, just to pick up on something, I mean, the association of philosophy with maleness, isn't it due, and the difference between philosophy and other humanities subjects and sciences, so isn't it due to simply the fact that in philosophy you spark, I mean, part to the fact that the persons and the personalities behind the theories are, well, maybe they don't matter, but they're always kind of, they're always there, let's say. There was Plato behind and some ideas, there was Aristotle behind another idea. Who say what matters, or at least is constantly there with philosophy in a way that is not there, of course, with the sciences and not with history. Of course, that's great stories, but it's not these figures are pushed on just.
Well, so what's interesting about that is, I think it's absolutely right that one thing that's going to lead to stereotyping philosophy as male is that we're taught all of these things, these theories which are by men, and we hear their names over and over and over again, right? But from what you'd said, you would predict that we should be doing better than that the sciences should be doing better than we are, because the scientists aren't constantly hearing the names of the people who did these things. You know, they're not as concerned with the history of the subject. And in fact, you know, the historians and literature people are. So we should be patterning with them, but we're not. We pattern with the scientists who aren't constantly giving us the names. So it's actually a kind of interesting phenomenon. And so I do a lot of talks on this to people who are trying to do something about women in academia in general. And they are often especially concerned with sciences, and they're just confused and surprised that I'm talking about syllabi, because it's just not an issue in the sciences, because you just have your textbook. There's the theories you need to learn. This is the stuff you need to learn. It's not about looking at people and what they've said and trying to interpret them and, you know, named arguments. It doesn't work that way. I think that probably does make it especially hard for us. And that's why I think it's very important that there's a lot of good work being done uncovering the roles that women have actually played in the history of philosophy. So women in early modern philosophy were, you know, extremely active, taken very seriously by the top men. And historians that I talk to are now coming to think that you can't really make sense of the early modern men without understanding the women who they were corresponding with, because that really helped to shape their theories. But they somehow got dropped out of the way that we study history. So I think anything we can do to get more women onto the syllabi will help.
Yeah, so you mentioned the phenomenon that when at a meeting a woman says something and then nobody takes it seriously until a man restates the same point. Do you know if there's any data about the similar kind of situation where the point just gets restated by another woman? So is it the gender that matters, or is it the fact that something just needs to be stated over and over again? Do you know what's the...
Okay, so I don't know. So what I do know is that men don't have the same thing happen to them. So men will be more likely to have their point acknowledged the first time without it being restated.
Alex. I'm wondering about anonymous marking. So I'm kind of an advocate for it, and it's not done here. And sometimes what people say against it is something like, we have so few students that it wouldn't make any difference. And I guess I wonder whether that, I kind of think, well, it would make a difference, and they say no, and then it's sort of a standoff. And I wonder whether there was any research that bears upon that question about when the numbers of the students drop, whether that means the effectiveness of anonymized marking drops as well, whether it's not
Yeah, it is imperfect, and people shouldn't think of it as a perfect solution. I do know certainly that, you know, although I mark in a system with anonymous marking, if a student has brought me a draft of their essay and I've commented on it, I know who it is, and the anonymity fails. It doesn't succeed in all cases. With small numbers of students, I would still think, unless they're all bringing you drafts, the anonymity is likely to work in more cases than not. But if the small numbers of students are all bringing you drafts to read, then yes, you're going to recognize them, and it might be pointless. So if you have three students who all bring you drafts, don't bother. But I think if you have 10 students and they're not bringing you drafts, you might recognize one or two, but you're not going to recognize all of them, and it is worth trying. But it's actually very hard to do good studies of anonymous marking, and there aren't many out there.
Okay.
Questions. First one is just something that really puzzled me, and I was wondering whether you could maybe speculate on this a bit more, which was this idea that if boys and girls are asked to do some kind of value affirmation exercise, that this does not have any effect on boys. Why? That's my first question.
Yeah.
And the second question, I was just thinking that you mentioned that you have several of these projects ongoing and a new project coming up to deal with these questions of gender bias. And I was just wondering if maybe the fact that you hire 60 permanent women shows an implicit bias in your committee that women are better in dealing with these topics. If you've been hiring in relation to these topics, do you see what I mean?
No, we haven't been hiring in the
other. Okay,
but yeah. So now I've forgotten what your first question was.
The
values affirmation, yeah. Okay. The idea is that what the values affirmation does is it makes you focus on a value part of your identity rather than a part of your identity that's making you feel nervous. And the reason this seems to have a positive effect on the women in the physics class but not the men is that the men aren't suffering from stereotype threat and the women are. So all it's doing is correcting for stereotype threat. And if you don't have stereotype threat there to start with, it's not going to make a difference. That's the theory, anyway.
I suppose it depends on how the exercise is articulated, right? I mean, what kind of, do they pick what kind of value they want to talk about?
So what they did was they had, they because they wanted to do a properly controlled study, they had two groups, and men and women were in both groups. One group was told to pick a value that's very important to them and write about it for 15 minutes. The other group was told, pick something that other people value that you don't, and write about it for 15 minutes. And the only group that got a boost was the group was the women who were writing about something they themselves valued. All the other ones, their scores just stayed the same. It's weird. I find it surprising too. Because I would think, you know, anyone's a bit nervous in the physics class, and it probably makes you feel, if it makes you feel good, it'll help, but it doesn't seem to.
So I was wondering whether you have any data on other countries, US and UK, so are there differences between UK and US, and let's say France and Germany or Scandinavia, and if there are other explanations for that, are there maybe different
I'm waiting for people to send me data. In Canada, it's better than the U.S. It's in the 30s. I can't remember exactly what it is. I don't know.
So there's no research being done on.
It doesn't. I'm not saying there's no research being done. So I know that there's some being done in Sweden, but I haven't got the figures yet. You know, so I know some places are doing the research.
Maybe
It's, you know, I'd love to have it.
It could be really useful because
absolutely.
If the numbers are different, then you
then we want to know why. Yeah.
Exercise.
Yeah.
My intuition is it's not. Well, in a sense, what I've experienced while being at the departments in Europe, in Germany in particular, I think it's I would say it's.
But you could argue that, I guess, the French way of arguing is somehow maybe less aggressive, maybe less adversary, or aggressive.
Yeah, so are you getting at the continental analytics split? Is that where you're going with it? Because that's an interesting question, and that's something people do sometimes ask me about, and I don't have studies that break it down along those lines, and I think it would be interesting. I know analytic philosophers tend to think that everything must be better for the women in continental philosophy. If you talk to women in continental philosophy, they don't agree. It's different, but it's bad in different ways.
And with the stereotype threat, of course, it's to some extent self-sustaining if you start with the all whites.
Yeah.
Situation, then the stereotype would be all white men.
Yeah.
But probably all, academic discipline started at some point in that situation, and then some humanities managed to get out of this. And of course, could also to some extent be just mere luck.
And then it becomes self-sustaining. And I think, so I think there's some of that, as someone who works in philosophy of language, I'm very struck by the fact that, when I'm working on semantic pragmatic distinction, the people I'm reading are equally likely to be in philosophy or linguistics departments. Right? They're the same, we're doing the same stuff. But the linguists are, I think, 50% of whom, they have a lot of women. Philosophers, there's hardly any women.
When you go to formal semantics conferences, then seems to me it's not so bad.
Even though it's very, very formal.
So kind of discussion and so on, that's all very similar to philosophy, but of course they have these, in the beginning of the discipline, these very influential women.
So you've got these major, huge counter-stereotypical exemplars like Barbara Parsi and people like that, also, there is this self-sustaining element that you called attention to. So if you're a woman interested in those issues and you're trying to decide between linguistics and philosophy, you go visit the linguistics department, there's lots of women, you feel comfortable, you go visit the philosophy department and things might not feel so comfortable, you're going to go into the linguistics. And so it does become self-sustaining in those areas. But one thing I really do want to study, and I've never been able to get a good answer to this, I want to know how biology changed so dramatically, how psychology is now majority female in some countries. I want to know how these sciences changed so dramatically in such a short time, and I haven't had anyone give me really convincing information on that. I mean, after the fact, people say things like, oh, but psychology is about people and understanding, and that's all feminine and stuff, right? But this very much has the feel of an after-the-fact justification. I mean, medicine used to be really, really male, and it was a macho male thing about healing and power. And then as it becomes more female, it's about, female virtues, like helping people. So it just, these feel like they're after-the-fact justifications.
I wanted to ask... the main focus was on what other people can do in order to reduce this stereotype. So I just wanted to clarify that is like something that the person under the stereotype can do in order to be not to be under this stereotype as well. Was it just the awareness that you kind of emphasized?
Okay, so lots of these can be turned around to things that you can do, and there's others. So you can do your own values affirmation exercise. You can sit in the philosophy department and write a little 15 minutes about something that matters to you. And in fact, it's not actually hard to work that into a philosophy essay if you really want to. you can think about yourself in terms of a group membership that is stereotyped as good at philosophy rather than one that's stereotyped as bad at philosophy. You can remind yourself that you might be likely to suffer from stereotype threat and that this is the anxiety you're feeling could be due to stereotype threat rather than to, actually being bad at philosophy. Another thing you can do that's very helpful is think about counter-stereotypical exemplars. If you don't have enough around in your department, you can carry a picture of Sally Haslinger in your wallet. I might start to find it creepy. So that's why we shall hire more women, so we don't creep Sally out. lots of these things are things that you can turn into things to do for yourself. They're not perfect, but it does make a difference. When I was just starting to work on this stuff, I had been reading about it and learning about it. I don't think I'd even written a paper on it. I was giving a paper in another department, and I arrived in the department, and the room I was in was this old wood-paneled room with lots of pictures of philosophers on the wall, like over 100 pictures. There are lots of pictures of philosophers covering the walls. And every one of them was a white man that I could see. In fact, directly behind me there was one woman, but I didn't see her. And everybody in the room was male. And in fact, two women arrived and came in late, sat in the corner. And I found, even though it was a paper I'd given lots of times before, I found myself stumbling over my words and struggling to come up with answers to questions. And I realized as I was doing this that, you know, this is probably stereotype threat. I've just been reading about that. And it helped me a little, but I have to admit it didn't fix it. I still found it very odd. Yeah.
I wonder, what would your advice on something that I've been thinking about in connection with intro classes, as to whether one should speak about implicit biases and stereotypes in such classes, given that you maybe have only less than an hour, and this is the only time you talk about that? Because, as you perhaps mentioned, and the study showed, very often it becomes worse, right? When you make them explicit, that there are such things, there are biases, and so on. So I wonder whether there's a good way to even speak about these issues.
I don't think that discussing it makes it worse.
No?
No.
But at least they have these tests or studies involving black or race. Yeah, so you kind of, once you are, you know, you make your associations, and then they tell you, do you realize that if you have this bias, and then you repeat this, then it's much worse. You start acting.
Okay, so I think it all depends on what you do when you tell people about it.
Exactly, yes.
So if you tell people, you have this bias, but, you know, everybody does, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Then it gets worse. Right. But if you tell them you have this bias, but it causes serious problems. You know, this is a really bad thing to have, this bias. Here's why. Here are some of the effects it has in the world, and here are some things you can do to fight it. Then it gets better because people can use those methods to fight it. Right. So you have to. I think telling people about it without giving them methods of combating it is a big mistake. I think you need to give people methods of combating it. And although, you know, I don't think people should be blamed just for having the biases, but nor did I think you should say, yeah, you know, everybody has these. Just, you know. I mean, I think actually everybody has these, and we need to wake up and we need to do something about it.
I have more additional comment than a question. But you mentioned that when in the hiring process, what turns out is that when it comes to women, suddenly having a lot of experience begins to play a higher role than in case of men.
It's not a general claim. No. This is a specific study that shows that the criteria shift so that whatever happens, it favors the male candidate. So this is a study where you've got a male candidate with experience but no credentials, a female candidate with what matters for the job is experience and credentials, and then they vary whether the male or the female candidate has which one. And whichever one the male candidate has is what is judged most important to that job. So it's not that generally experience is judged more important. It's if it's the thing that the male candidate has, that's judged to be more important.
Yeah, I assume you said this first thing, and then just having recently heard a talk where they reported a study the study was about the voting habits of Estonian voters, and they studied how are men and women likely to vote given what is the gender of the candidate. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty equal, but there turned out to be one factor which influenced the choice, and that was exactly having experience. But if a woman didn't have experience, then the man with equal non-experience was much more likely to get into active voting in politics, whereas women with no experience had very, very low chances.
All right, interesting. Yeah, no, it wasn't a general claim like that. This was about how the people vary it in order to favor the male candidate.
Okay, we have to finish here. Okay. So.